church are dismissed. You are in Al's authority right now. Al implements the three-strike rule. Hallelujah. Glory to God. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Exodus 23. This will be the last part of a many-part series we've been doing on the seven promises of God if we give during the three specific times of the year. The three feasts that we have learned are God's feasts. They are not the Jews' feasts. They are not the Gentile feasts. But they are God's feasts. As a matter of fact, if you look in Exodus 23, where we're going today, you could also look at Deuteronomy 16 and Leviticus 23. It clearly states that these feasts are extraordinary feasts. They are special feasts. They are a special season. They are an appointed time. Now listen, we've spent months and months preaching and learning about appointed times. We went all the way back into Genesis 1, 14, and 16, and we found out that God said that He placed the sun, moon, and stars in the heavens for us for signs for appointed seasons. There are like flares that God sets off in heaven. So we even went into studying the blood moons. We studied the Shemitah. We studied the year of Jubilee. We see how everything is funneling into the year of 2015. This is a very, very important appointed time, a strategic time in the history of the world. All supported by the blood moons. I mean, it is an absolute miracle to go back and study 1942 and see that the Spanish Inquisition and how they tried to kill all the Jews. And there was four specific blood moons during that year and a half period, all falling specifically on the eve of the Passover and the eve of the Feast of Tabernacles, then Passover, then the Feast of Tabernacles. Every single time, the exact same periods. Only happened seven times in the history of the world since Jesus walked the face of the earth. And I believe these are signs, these are stamps where God says, listen, I'm showing you from past history that I honor these times of the year, and He wants us to honor them. So what we did is we went into Exodus 23, in verse 14, and it says this, Exodus 23, 14 says this, these three times a year, you shall keep a feast in the year unto me. You shall keep the feast of unleavened bread, or the feast of the Passover, as I commanded you at the appointed time in the month of Abib. For in it you came out of Egypt. No one shall appear before me empty-handed. The feast of the first, the feast of the harvest, the first fruits of your labor which you had sown in the field, and the feast of the ingathering at the end of the year. So we went into these three specific chapters, which would be Exodus 23, Deuteronomy 16, and Leviticus 23. And we looked at these three times of the year. God breaks them down specifically and tells us that we're to honor the Passover, of which now we know Jesus was the Passover Lamb. And while they were honoring the Passover during the Last Supper, Jesus gave us the communion. He took bread, and after giving thanks, He broke it. He said, "This is my body which is given for you." He said, in the same manner, after supper, He took the cup. And after blessing it, He said, "This is the blood of the new covenant. For as often as you eat of this bread and also drink of this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until He returns back to this earth." There's a question for you. Would that be the thing that some people call the rapture, and then no one ever else does it after that? Or do we do it until the true return of Christ, when that seventh trumpet blows? So we're learning these things. We're seeing that Jesus, He honored the Passover. He was the Passover Lamb. He gave us a way as a reminder to remember that Passover. A lot of people today don't even tie the two together. We went into Matthew 26. We looked at the woman that had the alabaster box of perfume. That was 1 year of wages that she brought to Jesus, and she poured that over his head, and the disciples got very angry because she had blessed him. She had blessed him while they were honoring that Passover. And Jesus said clearly, he said, whatsoever this woman has done will be remembered. There'll be a memorial unto her because of what she did to honor him during that Passover. Now we know as we enter into this season of Passover, we already talked this evening a little bit on March 20th, there's going to be a solar eclipse. Now listen, I've been preaching this for a while. We know that all these blood moons take place. But there was only one other time in the history of the world that I could find that where there was a total solar eclipse in the midst of the four blood moons. And that was the year that Jesus was crucified. During that period of the four blood moons, there was a solar eclipse dead smack in the middle of the four blood moons. And here this is taking place again. Now we know that there's been seven tetrads, seven periods of these blood moons, all falling on incredible historical events. Now this year, and still, even as I study it now, it came into my spirit again the other night. I was thinking, I said, okay, there was Jesus. Okay, God sent his son. We know that here. Then we go over to 1492, and we see that what happened there, the Spanish Inquisition. Christopher Columbus discovers America. He gives the Jews a place to go while they were scattered abroad before they come into their homeland. Then we know in 1948, four blood moons, Israel became a nation. God sets them up. Four blood moons that year, 1967, the great Six-Day War, where they defended themselves, defeated all their enemies in 6 days, another four blood moon period. And then all of a sudden, as I'm looking at these times, I just say, hey, this year there's going to be four blood moons. And there's going to be a solar eclipse right in the middle of it. I'm thinking, in my spirit, I'm thinking, I'm praying and I'm studying this, and I'm thinking, what is going to happen? What is going to happen? I mean, is the church ready for it? I mean, are we ready for it? Are you ready for it? I mean, if the electric grid would go down tomorrow, are you ready? I mean, are you prepared? Do you know what you do? I mean, you've got to think of these things. Because I'm telling you, something major is going to happen. By the end of 2015, I'm going to tell you, mark down what I'm saying right now. By the end of 2015, something major, I mean, earth-shattering, earth-shaking event is going to take place. I mean, we're seeing now, I mean, Dolores sent me an email today about they were lining more Christians up and just cutting their heads off and killing these Christians and crucifying these little Christian boys and girls. I mean, it's just disgusting what this ISIS group is doing. And then here we got some leadership that just wants to put a hush on it, and people don't want to talk about it, don't want to look at it. And meanwhile, they're just overtaking areas. They're gaining strength, they're gaining power. You look at the situation that the church is in, I mean, it's a sad state that we're in. You think, how do we get into these messes? It's because people do not know how to submit unto leadership.
Amen.
That's what it all boils down to. There's just a bunch of rebels out there. We saw in Isaiah, I think it's 5:20, where it says that, woe to the nation that calls evil good and good evil. I mean, we studied all these things. These just aren't good lessons. I mean, these are things that we need to implement into our lives.
Amen.
Jesus said, don't be forgetful hearers of my word, but be ye effectual doers. This is what we have to do, man. When the rubber hits the road, we got to know what to do and how to prepare it. I mean, we got to be life changers. World changers. I mean, God's given us the insight. Hey, Why do you think we're getting all this food right now? You just think it's to get fat and happy. God's giving us a little insight to say, listen, prepare yourselves. This is an abundance right now to where you better be preparing. You better be storing up. You better be like that wise squirrel. You better be burying some nuts somewhere. Because I'm telling you, if the grid goes down tomorrow, there's going to be a lot of people going hungry. Just think, your microwave ain't going to work. That's going to be the least of your problems. They said, I forget the statistics, it's so insane, but I think they said 90% of all America would die within 6 months if the grid went down. Just think about that. Homer, is that right? Is my math right? All right. As long as you think and I think, we're okay. We're the majority this evening. Deuteronomy 23, verse 20. This is what happens when we honor these three times of the year. God gave us a promise. He said this, one, behold, I'll send my angel before you to keep you in the way and to bring you into the place which I have prepared for you. We know everything in this ministry is about proper positioning. Everything is about proper positioning. You got to fight to be in proper positioning. And I'm telling you, when God places you there, you cannot, you know that old song, I shall not be moved? That's what you got to do. I shall not be moved, because all hell comes against you when God places you in that place and says, listen, this is your divine destiny. This is the place I have called you to be. This is where I'm going to prepare you for the greatest works of your life. So the scripture that we found this in, some New Testament verses, I can't go back into all this all the time, I get in trouble. But in Acts 5:19 and also in Acts 12:4, for those who know the word, you know that Peter was thrown in prison. These two different times, and it specifically says right in there, especially in 12, I think it was, where it says that right after they had honored the Passover. See, that we don't even know. There's Gentiles now today in the church. First of all, up until this past year, they never knew nothing about the blood moons. They never knew nothing about the Shemitah. They never knew nothing about the Jubilee. These are all things that God is just pouring out into the church. Very few Christians can see how the Passover is a direct link to what we celebrate as communion. As Jesus said, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. We went in and I'm so fired up tonight, I feel like I'm on a bus. I could be all over the place, but I'm just going to try to stay kind of controlled. I'm going to try to stay controlled, right, okay? If I go running around the church, just follow me with the camera. All right? You chase me. You feel like running? All right. He said, behold, I send my angel before you to keep you in the way in which to bring you into the place which I prepared. God has prepared a place for every single one of you. You've got to get to that place. We saw, he said, verse 21, beware of him. Obey his voice. Don't provoke him, for he will not pardon your transgressions, for my name is in him. But if you indeed obey his voice and do all that I speak, then I'll be an enemy to your enemies and an adversary to your adversaries. Now listen, that's a promise right there. I stand on these promises. I don't know about you, but we've given so much at times it hurts. So I know what these seven promises are, and I say, hey God, listen, you said I ain't even got to fight my adversaries. You said you'd fight them for me. God will fight my fight for me. God will fight my battle for me. God will take care of my life. I don't have to do that. So then when we go into the New Testament, because people don't see these things, we see that when Peter was thrown in prison, boom, the first thing that God did was what? Dispatched an angel. Now normally an angel don't come around and just give you, okay, do this, do that, do this, do that. When all these times where it says that they were honoring the Passover, this angel automatically appears and he says, listen, I'm going to tell you what to do. You need to get up, gird yourself, put on your sandals, and get out of here. It gives them simple instructions to do. Then it says immediately, Immediately Peter got up, put on his sandals, girded himself, and got out of there. They knew this word. This word was some of the things, the foundational truths that these Jews were, they knew this was their whole life. Still today, during these seasons, man, the Jews migrate back to their homeland. Hey, they still celebrate the Passover. They just don't see it as the communion as we do. The Feast of Pentecost, we know the Feast of Passover, it was fulfilled in Jesus. We know the Feast of Pentecost, 40 days after the resurrection of, 50 days after the resurrection of our Lord. 7 weeks, it's called the Feast of Weeks. You count 7 weeks, and then the day after that, which would be 50, was the day that Jesus sent the Holy Ghost. Then we know the Feast of the Ingathering at the end of the year was the Feast of Tabernacles. It was when they went out and they stayed out there in the wilderness and all these things. But the first two have already been fulfilled. Now we're just waiting for the trumpets to blow. Hallelujah. The trumpets are going to blow, I'm telling you. So make sure you have your ears cleaned out. God, he said, I'll be an enemy of your enemies, and I'll be an adversary of your adversaries. For my angel will go before you, and he will bring you into the Amorites, Hittites, Perizzites, Canaanites, Hivites, Jebusites, and I will cut them off. Now, when we study that, a lot of people read over that, and they don't understand this. The angel is just not automatically going to lead you into a land of milk and honey. Amen. He's going to take you into a battle. He said, my angel will go before you and bring you into, well, hey, where did the Spirit lead Jesus? In the wilderness. Matthew 4:4. He said, he led him right into the wilderness. Why? To be tempted by the devil. This is how we're found trustworthy. We're not found trustworthy because we say we are. We're found trustworthy because we're found trustworthy.
Amen.
That's another great revelation for you. He said, you shall not bow down to their gods, nor serve them, nor even do according to their works. Now here's what I love. But you shall utterly overthrow them and completely break down their sacred pillars. This is where God is calling the church today, not to be just like them, but to come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. Well, I mean, we got to get out of there. People go, well, what happened to America? Well, I'm just here to tell you. I mean, you could go back even to 1925 when they started to brainwash people and not to talk about creation, but to accept evolution as a way of something that needed to be taught in our schools. Then you go up to 1962 and you see how they decided to take prayer out of the school. Then by the time 1963 hit, they had the Bibles removed out of school. You couldn't take the Bible and read the Bible in schools anymore. And then it was only 10 years later, by 1973, we had Roe versus Wade. They legalized abortion. Since then, over 55 million babies have been slaughtered. I mean, these things got to get into your spirit. These things got to be a way of seeing what God has been doing on here. We think, how do these things happen? It's just that little bit of gray area where that devil gets in there. And I'm telling you, man, I'm just so much I want to go preach about Adam and Eve. But see, we're in the Passover season, and I just feel like I'm going to bust because I see how God sent that man in that garden as the head of the garden, and he said, listen, I've placed you here. This is yours to take care of. This is yours to watch. This is yours to keep. It's just like the church.
Amen.
Then here that old stinking devil come in, and the devil never comes to headship. The devil never comes to leadership. He always finds a weaker link. He always goes in the back door. He always tries to get around and come in to manipulate and intimidate and do all the things that he can do by not coming to headship.
Amen.
So then he comes to the woman and he said, hey, hath God really said? And just plant that little bit of doubt And then, man, we could study that dialogue back and forth and back and forth. And listen, they could have done anything. Go out, plant your own garden. Go out, drain your own syrup. Go out, do your own stuff. You can go out and do whatever you want, but just don't do the one thing that God said not to do. Just one thing. Just one thing not to do. No, you can do a million things over here. I give you it. I give you the land. I give you everything. I bless you. You guys can run around. You can go do whatever you want. But just don't do this. And what did they do? That. And that has been the problem with all of mankind, all of humanity, and all of the church since then. I can go back and show you in history every single time that an ordained by God woman or man was placed in a specific position and that leadership was usurped, problem followed that. Amen. Look at our country. These little decisions here, there, and everywhere, and then we get into the things more lately about the legalization of same-sex marriages. See, they just give it a nice name. A nice name. But hey, we got to go by the Word of God. We believe in freedom of speech. Freedom of speech. Exodus 23:25 says this, so you shall serve the Lord your God, and he will bless your bread and your water. When we went into what every one of these things are, we looked at the angel, we looked at the protection, we looked at God fighting our battle, we looked at the bread, we looked at the provision, we looked at the water. He said, I'll even take sickness away from you. These are promises. Sickness is number four. I'll take sickness away even from the midst of you. No one shall miscarriage or be barren in your land. And then he says, I will fulfill the numbers of your days. Now listen, did I not go back and show you a direct correlation? Listen to this. Listen. He said, I will take sickness away from the midst of you. No one shall miscarriage or be barren in your land. And I will fulfill the number of your days. Now, that's what happens when you honor the Passover and you come before God and you're not empty-handed and you respect the Passover and you honor him. Then Jesus came to the Passover and he said, this is how you're going to honor it. You're going to bless the bread. You're going to take it, break it, give it, take the wine, drink it, do all this in remembrance of me. And then all of a sudden Jesus said this, and you got to put the two together. He said, for this reason, he said, many don't know how to rightly examine their own self. He said, for this reason, there are many sick among you. Well, I wonder what that is. Does this sound something like this? He said, and I will take, if you honor the Passover, I will take sickness away from the midst of you. And Jesus said, because now in the New Testament, when we honor and look at that Passover, and we celebrate that supper by doing the partaking of what we call communion, Jesus said, because you don't know how to rightly examine your body, now there are many sick among you, and also many sleep. Many are dead. Why? Because they don't know how to rightly examine their own bodies. Here, he said, and I'll take sickness away from you, and I'll also fulfill the number of your days. Two out of the seven that he clearly stated exactly during the communion. Okay, then he said, I will send my fear before you, and I will cause confusion among the people to whom you come, and I'll make your enemies turn their backs, and I'll even send hornets before you, which shall drive out the Hivites, the Canaanites, the Hittites from before you. Then he says, I'll not drive them out before you in 1 year, lest the land become desolate and the beasts of the field become too numerous for you. Verse 30, underline this in your Bible. Little by little I will drive them out from before you until you have increased and you inherit the land. God says, listen, we have this McDonald mentality. We just think, man, we can pull up God, do this, God, do that, God. And then all of a sudden, boom, all this stuff happens. No. God said he's going to be very precise. He's even going to send hornets before you. I thought, what is that? I mean, it could be a pestilence. We know what God did in Egypt. But it's that terror of the Lord. It's the fear of the Lord. Because as we're going to see, said this happened to two of these Amorite kings. And when these kings used to hear about what God's army would do when they'd come into a place to overtake them, such fear would come on them, they'd just run out of there. And the Israelites could be outnumbered by tens of thousands of soldiers. And just because they'd be going into an area, they'd just evacuate the camp. Because they knew what happened to that Egyptian army in the Red Sea. Look, let's go back over to Joshua 24. I'm trying to show you about God's protection. God will protect you. God will protect you. Now watch this. Joshua 24. Hallelujah. He said, 24:6. Joshua 24:6. Then I brought your fathers out of Egypt. See, this was their example. He said, I brought your fathers out of Egypt. And you came to the sea, and the Egyptians pursued your fathers with chariots and horsemen to the Red Sea. So they cried out to the Lord, and he put darkness between you and the Egyptians, and he brought the sea upon them, and he covered them up. And your eyes saw what I did in Egypt. Then you dwelt in the wilderness a long time, and I brought you into the land of the Amorites, who dwell on the other side of the Jordan. They fought with you, but I gave them into your hand that you might possess their land, and I destroyed them before you. Then Balak, we studied this, then Balak the son of Zippor, the king of Moab, arose to make war against Israel, and said and called Balaam the son of Beor to curse you. But I would not listen to Balaam. This is why we went back in and studied all this. He said, therefore he continued to bless you. So I delivered you out of his hand. Then you went over the Jordan, came to Jericho. Then the men of Jericho fought against you. Now listen, we remember all these battles. We remember all these specific battles where we said, hey, they went into Jericho and they circled the city for six days. And then on the seventh day, they went around and just blew the trumpets. Now that would be crazy to go around that city once a day and just whoo, whoo, blowing the horns, getting everybody's attention. You'd think that it killed them. Sometimes it just doesn't make sense, but you got to do what the Lord tells you to do. Because you can't be trusting anybody beside him. As long as you keep your eyes on him, you're not looking at the archers up there on the wall thinking they're going to pierce your heart with an arrow. Oh, watch what happened. He said, and the men of Jericho fought against you also, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Girgashites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. He said, but I delivered them into your hand, and I sent the hornet before you, which drove them out before you. This goes directly back to Exodus 23. These men, these soldiers in the armies of God, they understood that God would send a hornet before them. It was the fear of the Lord. It was that spirit of just torment where these people knew that, hey, these people were submitted to God. And guess what? God was fighting their battles. Amen. They knew it. Not like today. I mean, people think, hey, what's right, what's wrong? We don't know what's right. Everybody got their own opinion. You just love everybody. Anybody can do what they want to do. I mean, that is so contrary to what the Bible teaches. Amen. Sure, we love everybody, but the part about doing what you want to do, I mean, that's where God may have a difference of opinion. Amen. He said, I sent the hornet before you, which drove them out before you, and also the two kings of the Amorites, but not with sword. Not with sword, not with your sword, or with your bow. He said, I have given you a land for which you did not even labor. These are the supernatural things that we are talking about being given into your life because you are in right position. Amen. seen so many supernatural things happen in people's lives. And then we wonder, I mean, how could you come into position and how could you be so blessed and then how could you just mess that up? Listen, I'm telling you, that's not natural. Because even a dog does not bite the hand that feeds it. Amen. Dogs don't even bite the hand that feeds them. You've got to be able to see, well, wait a second, God's doing something here. God's blessing me. God's a... But if you think about those Israelites, I mean, they weren't even out of Egypt and they were just cursing God. They were mad at Moses. They wanted a new king. They were barely out of town. They wanted to go back. They liked the grapes better. Listen, this is the type of the world. This is some things we're trying to learn to worship. God's preparing us for something great. He said, I've given you a land for which you did not even labor, and cities which you didn't even build, and you dwell in them. You eat of vineyards and olive groves that you didn't even plant. Now therefore, I want you to fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and truth, and put away the other gods which your father served on the other side of the river in Egypt, and serve the Lord. And if it seems evil to you to serve the Lord, choose for yourself this day whom you'll serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. All right, let's go to, I want to show you something in Deuteronomy 7. Just real quick, we're going to go to Deuteronomy 7. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy 7. Hallelujah. Look at this. Let me show you something. You think these people didn't know this word? You don't think they knew these promises? You didn't think because they knew what times of the year they were supposed to come before God and give, and that they would be able to come boldly before the throne of God, that they would obtain grace and mercy in the time of need? Listen, you just can't go to God and just, okay, God, I just believe you're going to do this, so you got to do it. I mean, you try that. And once you figure out that don't work, you better figure out there's something wrong with your method. You got to get in proper position by doing what God has told you to do. That's the way you receive the blessings from God. Listen, many will come unto me in that day saying, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? Have we not cast out devils in thy name? Have we not done great mighty works in thy name? These are people that knew Jesus, or at least thought they did. And he's going to say, depart from me, workers of iniquity, I never knew you. We got to make sure we're on the right side of the fence. Amen. Listen, wide is the gate, broad is the way that leadeth into destruction, and many there are that go thereby. Very narrow is the gate, straight is the way that leadeth into eternal life, and there are few that find that. Amen. Hey, I see the more we preach and the more we teach, I mean, there's a lot of people come and go. You know why? It's because of what we preach and teach. It just doesn't tickle everybody's ears. If it makes them uncomfortable, then, you know, then sometimes you just, whatever. He said, man, some of this stuff is so good. Deuteronomy 7:17. If you should say in your heart, these nations are greater than I, how can I dispossess of them? And you shall not be afraid of them, but you shall remember what the Lord your God did to Pharaoh and to all of Egypt. Listen, this is the Passover. He said, the great trials which your eyes saw, the signs and wonders, the mighty hand and the outstretched arm by which the Lord your God brought you out, so shall the Lord your God do to all the people of whom you are afraid. Moreover, the Lord your God will send what?
Hornets.
I'm thinking, there's that word again, hornets. I mean, I had never seen it before, and now I'm starting to tie it into all these great, mighty works that God did by what I found in Exodus 23. That he promised to even go before you and fight your battles for you, He'll even send a hornet if he has to before you. Or, which it really means is the fear of the Lord. To go before you. He said, God will send the hornet among them until those who are left who hide themselves from you are destroyed. They'll even try to hide themselves from you. You can't find them if you want to find them. He said, you shall not be terrified of them, for the Lord your God, the great and awesome God, is among you. Then tell me, does this remind you of what we just read? He said this, and the Lord your God will drive out the nations before you little by little. It's exactly what he promised them in Exodus 23. He said, listen, when you honor me these times of the year and I go out and I send my angel before you and I'm going to fight your battles before you, he said, now wait a second. I'm not going to just come in and just dominate. He said, I'm going to do it little by little. Now, why does God, I'm telling you, God is so precise. Why does God just do it little? Jesus said, I come that they would have life and have life more abundantly. Amen? God wants to give you everything. God would just love to just give you and say, here, there you go. But he knows because of how the people treated him in the past. Now, all of us may say, oh, I'd never do that. I wouldn't do that. I wouldn't do this. I wouldn't do that. Pastor, we're going to be there forever. You can count on us forever. We're going to be here 50 years from now. And then next 5 minutes, you never see him again. This is why God himself says, I will move them out little by little. I'm going to fight your battle for you right here. I'll even do it with a hornet. I'll send fear out there little by little. Until, what we'll see there, he says, until you can take care of them yourself. Because once you're found trustworthy, then you can fight the battle for yourself. But listen, he said, if I just give it to you all at once, then the beasts in the field are going to come in and they're going to devour you. I'd rather God come in and do it just a little bit by little bit, and then you can just see, okay, that's how that's going to happen. This is how this is going to happen. That's how this is going to happen. You see? Oh my God, I would have never thought that would happen. Hallelujah. He said, and the Lord God will drive out those nations before you little by little, and you will be unable to destroy them at once. See, everybody wants to do it at once. You can't destroy them at once. Because God said, I'm just going to give it to you little bit by little bit. Why? Lest the beast of the field, listen, become too numerous for you. But the Lord your God will deliver them over to you and will inflict defeat upon them until they're destroyed. And he will deliver their kings into your hand and he will destroy their name from under heaven. No one shall be able to stand against you until you've destroyed them. This is exactly what he said in Exodus 23. Now, let's go back over to Joshua. Let's go back over to Joshua 2. Joshua 2. Man, I just love the word. Rose came in tonight. She said, I love just studying the word. Oh, watch this. Joshua 2:1. Now Joshua the son of Nun sent out two men from the Achaia Grove to spy secretly, saying, go view the land, especially Jericho. So they went and came to the house of the harlot, the prostitute named Rahab, and they lodged there. And it was told the king of Jericho, saying, behold, the men have come here in the night from the children of Israel to search out our country. So the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring out the men who have come to you who have entered your house, for they have come to search out all the country, not preached on Rahab. Now watch this. Then the woman took the two men and hid them. And she said to the men, then she said, yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they were from. Now, is that the truth?
Yeah.
No, that's not the truth. She lied. One of the greatest feats in the Bible, and I'm not encouraging you to lie, but I just want you to see a little grace in this story. Just a little bit of grace here. Yes, the man came to me, but hey, I didn't even know there were where they were from. And it happened as the gate was being shut when it was dark that the men went out, and where the men went, I don't know. Pursue them quickly, for you know who take them. Is any of that true? Nope.
No.
She took them right in the house and hid them. And then she lied what she did to save their life. But she had brought them up to the roof and hid them with the stalks of flax which she had laid in order on the roof. Then the men pursued them by the road to the Jordan to the fords. And as soon as those who pursued them had gone out, they shut the gate. Now before they lay down, she came back up to them on the roof and said to them, I know that the Lord has given this land. Listen. I know that the Lord has given you the land. That the terror, that's that hornet. It's the same word for hornet. He said, that the terror of you has fallen on us. And that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. They didn't even have to fight the battle. He said, for we have heard how the Lord dried up the waters of the Red Sea. When they see God working in your life, there's not much more they can say.
Amen.
I mean, and I'm saying this humbly, and God knows my heart. I mean, I'm seeing some stuff in this ministry that I've never seen in like 37 years, 38 years now serving God.
Amen.
I mean, I'm seeing bushels of provision. I'm seeing people given cars. I'm seeing people getting better jobs. I'm seeing people healed of cancer. I'm seeing people get back in their right mind. I'm seeing God move in all this. And in the midst of that, you'll see people do the craziest things. I'm like, what could you possibly be thinking? God himself is moving in our midst, and God wants to change lives, and we'll just get in our little flesh bag, and we'll just get, woo. I think, can't you see the big picture? God is doing something. Listen. That is why it is so important to never forget that it is so simple as this. Have God really said? People always think, oh, it's some big deal how people have fallen or how nations have fallen or how people slide away and how people get in trouble and how people do. Listen, it's always something little. The devil is the most subtle beast of the field.
That's right.
It's hard. I mean, you know snakes are somewhere. You can't even find them. They're there. You can't find them. You're there, this, that. I mean, for we have heard, verse 10, how the Lord dried up the waters of the Red Sea. For when you came out of Egypt, and we saw what you did to the two kings of the Amorites who were on the other side of the Jordan.
Man, when I saw that, I said, hey, that's just what he talked about in Joshua 24 and in Exodus 23. He said, I'm going to send a hornet out before you just like I did with those two kings of the Amorites. We need to go back and study what happened to the two kings of the Amorites.
I mean, you might not like to see some of this stuff, but you might really enjoy it. But I know one thing. They remembered the Passover, and they remembered what happened to the people when they came out of Egypt, when it was delivered out of the ways of the world. I get a couple minutes, don't I? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers 14. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, man, I just love it. Listen to some of this stuff. I just read some. I hit the high spots right here. Listen. Numbers 13, 25. And they returned from spying out the land after 40 days, and they departed and came back to Moses and Aaron, and they said, all the congregation of the children of Israel in the wilderness of Paran Kadesh, and they brought back word to them and to all the congregation and showed them the fruit of the land. And when they told them and said, we went to the land where you sent us, and it truly flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit. Nevertheless, the people who dwell in the land, hey, they're strong. Sometimes you put your eyes on your adversary and not God. You think, oh, I could never overcome that. I could never do that. I could never do this. And you get your eyes off Jesus. Amen. The cities are fortified and very large. And moreover, we saw the descendants of Anak there and the Amalekites and dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites and the Amorites dwell in the mountains. And thus the Canaanites dwell by the sea and along the banks of the Jordan. Then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, let us go up at once and take possession, for we are well able to overcome it. Now listen, that was leadership. Now listen what happened. But the men who had gone up with him said, now this is where you get in trouble. The men who went up with him said, we are not able to go up against the people, for they are stronger than we. A little bit of dissension there in the ranks. He said, and they gave the children of Israel a bad report of the land which they had spied out, saying, the land through which we had gone has spies as a land that devours its inhabitants, and all the people whom we saw in it are men of great stature. And there we saw giants, the descendants of Anak came from these giants, and we are like nothing but grasshoppers. Little grasshoppers in our own sight. And so we were in their sight. Now, this is two ways of looking at things. Some people see the glass half full, and some people see the glass half empty. I mean, hey, Caleb was down here ready to go butcher him. He said, God's on my side. I'm ready to go take him. All his buddies were saying, no, don't do it. So here's what happened. He said, so all the congregation lifted up their voices and cried, and the people wept that night. And the children of Israel complained against Moses and Aaron and the whole congregation. I mean, listen to this. Hear this. If only we had died in the land of Egypt, or only if we had died in the wilderness, why has the Lord brought us to this land to fall by the sword, that our own wives and children should be taken victims in? And would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? Think how many people will leave the divine position or place that God has divinely set them and just desire to go back to Egypt because they just won't listen to what Moses or Aaron would say. Amen. I think, man, you've lost it. He said, would it not be better for us to return to Egypt? So listen, so they then said to one another, because they don't go over to Moses, they go back to one another and they say, so they say to one another, let us select a leader and return back to Egypt. You see how that works? They get back over there, pop, 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 pop. Well, okay, we don't want to tell them because that's the leadership, so what we're going to do is we'll go to everybody else and just try to get someone to take us back into Egypt. I think, hey, just think about how powerful Moses was. That was the man that God chose to deliver them out of so many years of bondage. If I'm not mistaken, it was 470 years of bondage. And God chose a man and he said, listen, I'm gonna bring up those people by your hand. Boom. And no sooner than he brought him out, guess what they wanted to do? They wanted to vote for somebody else. I'm thinking, is there something wrong with that picture? Amen. And people say to me today, how could the church have fallen? How could the church? Man, the church of the living God was so powerful, and it was such this and that. And how did we get to where we are? Well, when you look at it and you tell them, well, right here, here's a decision, right? Well, you know, that they just had their you know, freedom of speech, and you know, you didn't want to tell her she couldn't be a pastor, and you didn't want to tell him they couldn't be a pastor, so anybody could lead the sheep, and what's it going to hurt anyway? You never see any big problem in this. Has God really said it? Now you look at our lives and you should be concerned about your own selves and your own children and the things that could be happening within the next year. Because the four blood moons that we're experiencing this year with the solar eclipse right in the middle has never happened since the crucifixion of Jesus. We better be ready. March 20th is a lot more important than a bunch of wings and singing. There's going to be a solar eclipse that day. I don't care if you eat meat or not. You better be ready. This is some serious stuff. So many people lose sight of what God has done. Listen, has there ever been anything greater than the way God delivered the Israelites out of the land of Egypt? We think today, oh, people do this and people do that. Listen. That was some great acts. You go out there and do some of the things Moses did. Go over there to ISIS and try to do what Moses did. You'll be on a popsicle stick hung upside down with your head cut off, thinking you made a mistake. Those are the things that separate the men from the boys, because talk is cheap. Anybody can say, they're this, they're that, there, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. But when the rubber meets the road, you got to pay the bills. You got to get out there and build the ministry. You got to beat the devils off. You got to pray for the people. You got to do the stuff. No, they just wanted to knife Moses right in the back, just cut his throat. Just kill him. Man, let's just get rid of Moses. We want to go back to Egypt. Could never understand that. Hey, me, I've always just been, probably because of my athletic background, but I've just always been together. I said, hey, coach, listen, I don't want to call the plays. You just tell me what to do. I'll just do it. If the church, I'm talking the church, since the beginning of time, if the church just could have held on to that one concept, it could have been so powerful. But no, that one question always lingers there. Has God really said? Listen, there ain't going to be no denominations in heaven. I mean, we work with men and women today in the church ministry all over the place, and everybody's thinking they're the best thing since sliced bread. They've been there and done that and got the t-shirt, but I'm telling you, it don't matter if you're first Pentecostal, second Pentecostal, fifth Pentecostal, Pentecostal for holiness, first Baptist, second Baptist, or third Baptist. There ain't going to be a denomination in heaven. There's going to be people submitted under the kingship and the leadership of the Lord. I can't wait.
Amen.
I can't wait. I want to hear the words, well done, thy good and faithful servant. Enter into the house of the Lord. That's how close we are, man. I can almost hear the hoofbeats of them horses. I can hear the angels just getting ready for battle. I'm not going to take my sight off the prize. Nope. I don't care if the urinal leaks or not. I'm keeping my face set like a flint. I don't care if the hot water tank breaks or not. I don't care. I don't care if they let my mic on and my batteries go dead every single week. Bob got a whole patch back there. He changed these out so fast, I didn't even blink. He had it in and out, boom, ready to go. All this stuff is just stuff. Listen, Jesus is coming back.
Amen.
And I believe we're the generation.
Amen.
And I'm not losing sight of that no matter what.
Amen.
I told my aunts and uncles that years ago. They didn't believe me. I told my mother that years ago. She didn't believe me. They're believing me now. I said, I ain't losing. losing sight of where I'm going. I'm on the straight and narrow. You're rather on it or you're not. We're going into the kingdom together or I'm going without you. But I know one thing, I'm doing my best to get in there. I want to take as many people as I can with me. I want you to say someday, thanks. Amen. That's what it's all about. Nothing else matters. Amen. Nothing else matters. Amen. Father, in the blessed name of your Son Jesus, we thank you for this evening and for this word. I ask that you would write it upon our hearts that we would not sin against thee. Let this word be strength unto our bones. Let us mount up with wings as eagles. Let us run and not grow weary. Let us walk and faint not. Let us wait upon the Lord. Let us renew our strength. In Jesus' name, amen.